In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King. O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy. Have mercy.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, whose will is it to restore all things in your beloved Son, the King of the universe, grant, we pray, that the whole creation set free from slavery may render your majesty service and ceaselessly proclaim your praise through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, I myself will look after and tend my sheep. As a shepherd tends his flock when he finds himself among his scattered sheep, so will I tend my sheep. I will rescue them from every place where they were scattered when it was cloudy and dark. I myself will pasture my sheep. I myself will give them rest, says the Lord God. The lost I will seek out. The strayed I will bring back. The injured I will bind up. The sick I will heal. But the sleek and the strong I will destroy, shepherding them rightly. As for you, my sheep, says the Lord God, I will judge between one sheep and another, between rams and goats. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through man, the resurrection of the death came of the dead came also through man. For just as in Adam all die, so too in Christ shall all be brought to life, but each one in proper order. Christ, the first fruits. Then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to his God and Father, when he has destroyed every sovereignty and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. When everything is subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who subjected everything to him, so that God may be all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus said to his disciples, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him, and he will separate them, one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right, and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and visit you? And the king will say to them, amen, I say to you, whatever you did to one of the least brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill and in prison, and you did not care for me. Then they will answer and say, Lord, When did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs? He will answer them, Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me. And these will go off to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord. Good morning, everyone. I hope you can see me a little better. We got the lights fixed. Yeah, they came pretty good. And yeah, we could clap for that. You really feel the difference at nighttime. Someone said, Father, I liked it better when it was a little dimmer because it enhanced your appearance. One of the things these lights highlight are the flowers here. You can see, it's the Feast of Christ the King, and maybe you might think, wait a minute, wouldn't they be golden for a king's gold? But it's a wonderful combination of things happening. We have the patroness of Puerto Rico here, our Lady of Divine Providence, decked out in blue and white. And the flowers around the altar were provided by our Matthew 25 group, because today is their third anniversary, and they asked if they could decorate the altar for their anniversary. I said, of course. And they chose their own colors, blue and white, because those are the colors of Mother Teresa. I can never get used to calling her Saint Teresa of Calcutta. Mother Teresa was, Saint Teresa of Calcutta was always dressed in white and blue, so that was the choice. So it's a wonderful concomitance of these colors for the Feast of Christ the King. The reason they chose this, and all this comes together on the Feast of Christ the King. We need this Feast of Christ the King to remind us of Him, who is our loving King. I would say especially in this worst year in memory, 2020, for most of us, maybe not for all, for many anyway, it's been just an awful year. And therefore the need to remind us of Christ our King. And we get this parable for His kingship. And it reminds us of, in a stark way, because there's something striking about this parable, shocking even, that speaks about the kind of kingship that He wants. We don't honor this king with fanfare and trumpets. You know, he takes care of his own trumpets, or maybe in certain times that's okay too. But the message that this king gives us is that we would recognize him in the least, the last, and the lost. And I suppose that's why the Matthew 25 group, which was actually founded by Father Vincent in a different parish and now has a branch here, looks after the least, the last, and the lost, and they started on the Feast of Christ the King precisely for that reason. And the name of the Matthew 25 group comes from this gospel, Matthew, the 25th chapter of Matthew's gospel, where the payoff quote is, whatsoever you do to the least of my brothers and sisters, you do to me. And I thought maybe helpful to break down for us that we're called to live out this kingship of Christ as loyal subjects of His by making this parable a reality in how we treat the least, the last, and the lost. So it seemed opportune to me to just mention these seven principles by which Matthew 25 group operates. And I want to speak maybe just of a couple heroes who have lived this out and that will be my words for today. So the brief seven principles of our Matthew 25 group here. And the first is this. We reach out to help somebody up. If they fall again, we pick them up again. If they fall again, we pick them up again. Until one day, maybe, they can stand on their own. The second principle of this group is a quotation from St. Vincent de Paul, who said, "We must be so kind to the poor that they forgive us for the bread that we give them." My father always used to quote that from St. Vincent de Paul, and it's certainly counterintuitive, isn't it? We must be so kind to the poor that they will forgive us for the bread that we give them. But you get it? That the kindness that has to be shown to the poor has to be so overwhelming that they can even overcome the stigma of being a recipient of charity. Because it's hard to receive charity. It's much easier to give. That's what Jesus says. It's better to give than to receive. And that's our own lived experience as well. Number three, we understand that many whom we will serve will try to manipulate and take advantage. In responding to this reality, we avoid two extremes. One, that of washing our hands of them. And two, that of enabling their bad habit. That seems to be great wisdom there. Because the temptation when doing work of charity and taking care of the least and the last of the lost is to say, oh, they used what I gave them and bought drugs or alcohol with it. Therefore, I have no more responsibility to them. And yet that's not what the Lord is calling us to do. Or the other extreme, which says, I know they're just going to use this, entering into their reality, but I'm just going to give in to their alcoholism and buy it for them. That's not helping them either. So to avoid those two extremes. The fourth principle. Even if in certain cases we are unable to help those we're called to serve, we still accompany them with the love of Christ. It's true that not everyone can do everything, but we do what we can, and if we can't do it, we at least can still walk with them, even being willing to enter into their darkness, even if we can't bring them out of that darkness. Number five, Mother Teresa said, "The rich need the poor more than the poor need the rich." In that spirit, we see the poor as our benefactors. That's again one of those counterintuitive quotes that comes from this passage of Matthew's gospel, that what Jesus is saying, to put it in its starkest terms, if we don't help the poor and the needy, we will go to hell. That's what this parable is saying. It couldn't be, I couldn't put it more starkly than the reality that's coming of this page. That's why the rich need the poor to help them get into heaven more than the poor need the rich, because God will always provide for the poor. So, the sixth principle, we help the worthy poor, which is easy to do, and even more importantly, the unworthy or undeserving or ungrateful poor, which is much harder to do. That's what separates the men from the boys, to use that old expression. So it's easy to help the worthy poor. A family with five children, their house burnt down, and they have nothing to open up our wallets or purses to buy coats for that family. That's easy. Anyone would do that. But when someone who is undeserving or has not appreciated the help or has caused their own problems, yet they still have these human needs that we have to meet, that's a lot harder. And that's what Matthew 25 group strives to do. Number 7, we understand that our work is messy. There are no cookie-cutter solutions. Each case will require wisdom, but we see Christ in each one. I think that's one of the advantages of a Matthew 25 group, which just recognizes the need as it is. And it's one of the problems and why many slip through the cracks of government help. As great as that is, wonderful to live in New York City, has so many programs, but they offer often cookie cutter solutions that many people don't fit into this exact category by which they can help. And that's where Matthew 25 has to do its work. So maybe all these are nice principles, but I can share an example of one of many. This happened some years ago, changing the details a little bit so that, you know, no one could know that it would be. But it was after Mass here, one morning where poor fella, he'd been on the street for 2 weeks. First time in his life he'd been homeless, he was a senior citizen. And yet, maybe some bad choices, he was removed from the place where he was renting for some years. And he was weeping because he couldn't take it anymore. He couldn't live on the street. So we came in and sat in this back chapel right here and assessed the situation, everything. That was what he had going on. He wasn't eligible for government help. So, and I had to say the next Mass, so what do? I was on the lookout for a member of Matthew 25, the first one that walked in, make up a name. Hey, Wanda. And Wanda, I have to say the Mass, could you sit here with, make up another name, Lewis? Could you sit here with Lewis and see if there's any way you can help him? Wanda sat with Lewis and heard his story and said, you know what? You're going to come and live with us. We have a room in our apartment. You're going to come with us. That's exactly what happened. She and her husband took Lewis into their home, not for a day, but for weeks, and turned into months until he could get up on his feet and has his own little room now, little jobs here to keep it going. And they're my heroes for doing this. And it just struck me this time, I never picked it up before, and I dug a little deeper into it. When Jesus says to those who are on his right, who did treat him the least, the last, and the lost, in this way, in our translation it says, I was a stranger and you welcomed me. But I've heard other translations of that that says, I was a stranger and you took me in. I said, well, what is it? Did you welcome me? Because that's kind of easy. You say, hi, hi. That's a welcome. But so I looked it up, and the Greek word there is interesting. It's synagogein, which means you took me in. We get the word synagogue from that, where the people would gather in to God's house. And when we fulfill this passage, I was a stranger and you took me into your own, is the meaning of it. And so much the more is this couple heroes to me from here at our own Holy Cross Church, because they lived it out. They took someone in. That's huge. I want to mention one other hero to share the story of St. Peter Claver, because he was another one who lived out the Matthew 25 gospel. He was a native of the little island in the Mediterranean called Mallorca. Just a little island that's produced an incredible number of saints. And in fact, best friend of St. Peter Claver was another saint, St. Alonso Rodriguez. They were both Jesuits. They were together, and St. Alonso told his friend, St. Peter Claver, You know, they're calling for people to go to Colombia to work in the Jesuit mission there. Would you? I think you should go. And he was the type that would never request or refuse an assignment, but he was chosen to go, and he went. They sent him to Cartagena. And there, he recognized what was happening. This was in the 1600s. It's where the slave trade was in full swing. And his heart was wounded when he saw the conditions of what was happening with the slave trade. And he decided that he was going to become a slave to the slaves forever. That was his phrase. And that's what he lived out. I mean, for 35 years, no one knew how he did it. He slept very little. He only ate a few pieces of bread and some fried potatoes each day. But love and holiness were like fire in his veins and give him a stamina that was actually, by all accounts, supernatural. He never wasted away. He didn't succumb to the bad diet he had. He didn't get scurvy. He didn't even get any of the diseases of the poor slaves he cared for. I mean, imagine the horror. Africans were coming naked. Men, women, and children. The men were in chains. A third of them died at sea in these boats, cramped below deck, eating and drinking and evacuating themselves, stewing in their own filth, rolling at sea, ravaged by dysentery, the men's legs ulcerous for the shackles that they bore. They were fed nauseating food, and if they didn't eat it, they were flogged. And not even knowing why this was happening to them. This is the hell on earth that human beings make for other human beings sometimes. Until they met Father Claver. See, the slave traders were horrible Catholics, but they at least let Father Claver do his work. And when they arrived, he smiled and he spoke to them in Angolan Portuguese, or using African interpreters, or using even better the language that's universal, the language of love, caring for them, the language of gentle touch to comfort and soothe and give them encouragement. He fed them the first good food they had since they had been captured across the sea in Africa. He washed their wounds with wine. He cleaned their filth from their bodies. He bound up their sores. He covered their nakedness. They say the stench was so choking that no one except St. Peter Claver could endure it for more than a few minutes. And if he did notice it, he never acknowledged. Or maybe he just took it as a gift from God. He kissed them. He sucked the poison from their sores the way you would suck venom from a snake bite. That was the poison that came from putrefying flesh. If he couldn't walk, he would carry them. He would actually make carts for them so he could carry them, so they didn't have to hobble along under the lash. To those who were sick, first ministered to them, and he had water and ready and oil to baptize them if they could at least make them understand the merest notion of sin and far more important, Christ's salvation. But this experience of what they had, only a love beyond human reckoning could have won their hearts. And that's a love that the world does not know how to give. A love, in fact, that the world never even heard of before Christ. And for St. Peter Claver, Christ was the key. You see, we need more than just humanitarians. I mean, as great as that might be, it's not enough. St. Peter Claver was not a mere humanitarian. He didn't have a social agenda for the improvement of human beings. He was consumed with love for the individual. And the more miserable and the more needy, the more he loved them. Often a humanitarian won't sit at the bed of a dying man, except maybe to give morphine to relieve the pain more efficiently. But human beings need more than efficiency. You know, Jesus, our King, he would have died for any one of us, alone and individually. That's the kind of love he had for us, and that's not very efficient. And he did it because he wants our individual human friendship. Only a saint would go among the lepers. Many of the slaves had contracted leprosy, and they were sent to live in these colonies for their last days. St. Peter Claver went among them. And in those days, there was no PPE, there was no hand sanitizer. You can imagine a very good person in our day, in a temporary mission bolstered by all the protection of modern industry and the face mask, going among the lepers, being satisfied for years. But St. Peter Claver went among them more than just to perform the necessary medical tasks and then, you know, get away from them and breaking out in a cold sweat. He was eager to be among them. And to prove it, he did what no humanitarian could do. He touched them. He kissed them. He gave them their dignity back as human beings. And his actions spoke to them, saying, "You do not disgust me. You delight me. You're valuable to me. You need not be embarrassed in front of me because you are my brothers and my sisters." He did not run away from the plague. And I run away from suffering as if it were the plague. No wonder Pope Francis named St. Peter Claver the patron saint of Colombia when he was there 3 years ago. St. Peter Claver and those friends from Matthew 25 group here at Holy Cross, they wanted to give examples near and far so that we can have something concrete to just strive for, inspire to, so that when the end of our life comes, we could hear those words that we heard in this gospel. "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." Let us stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us call to mind the needs of the church and the world, bringing our concerns confidently before God's throne.
that the church proclaim the good news of God's reign. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That wealthy nations seek practical ways to relieve the crushing debt of poor countries. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the hungry be fed, the homeless find haven, the lonely be comforted, and those in prison know true freedom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the sick, especially those close to death, rise to new life in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the members of this community of faith be to one another a source of strength and trial. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our personal intentions and for all who have asked for our prayers, we pray for the repose of the souls of Roberto Velez, Eileen Marquez, Evarista Velasco, Benjamin Segay, Ligia Polanco, and Luis Lopez. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Felicita Montañez Pantoja, for whom this Mass is offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty and everlasting God, until the day when you gather us into your reign, grant that what we ask by the power of your Holy Spirit, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our second collection today is for Catholic Charities Campaign.
Please join in singing our offertory hymn, Shepherd Me, O God. From death.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
As we offer you, O Lord, the sacrifice by which the human race is reconciled to you, we humbly pray that your Son himself may bestow on all nations the gifts of unity and peace. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Eternal God, for you anointed your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, with the oil of gladness, as the eternal priest and King of all creation, so that by offering himself on the altar of the cross as a spotless sacrifice to bring us peace, he might accomplish the mysteries of human redemption. And making all created things subject to his rule, he might present to the immensity of your majesty an eternal and universal kingdom. A kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love, and peace. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make us of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Vincent de Paul, St. Alonso Rodriguez, St. Peter Claver, St. Teresa of Calcutta, and with all the saints from his constant intercession in your presence, we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Timothy our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you've gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To all our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, especially Felicita Montañez, Pantoja, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, trespass against us, and us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Join in singing our communion hymn, In Christ Alone.
My song, this corner.
Let us pray. Having received the food of immortality, we ask, O Lord, that glorifying in obedience to the commands of Christ, the King of the universe, we may live with him eternally in his heavenly kingdom, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Bunch of announcements, everyone, before the final blessing. First is just a word of thanks for coming. You know, we're in code yellow here in this section of the Bronx, and yet you're still here and in good number. I wondered maybe that our numbers might go down, but thanks for your trust in the protocols that we're strict to follow here. And we're going to keep going. I should mention that one of the ways that we're still going forward is with youth ministry. Now, there's certain ways that we cannot continue with the instructional level in person. Religious education in person is held back. But because our church is open and worship can continue, in that vein, we're going to continue with our youth ministry. This past Wednesday, we had a great beginning with our young people for high school age. And this coming Friday, they're going to continue on Wednesdays, including this Wednesday. This coming Friday, we'll begin our in-person option for middle school youth ministry, 6:45 p.m. this Friday, we're cleared to go. The Archdiocese has reviewed our plan, and even though we're in code yellow, it doesn't stop us, and we're going to keep following all those protocols that keep us safe and sound and moving forward. We start with a new year this coming weekend. Right after Thanksgiving weekend, it actually is the feast or the beginning of the Advent season. Liturgically, it's a new year. So that's why we can say happy liturgical new year when we meet again next week. We go away from the white and the green. We embrace purple. They even have the purple masks available there. I know I got mine already yesterday, so I'm ready for the liturgical season of Advent. And I mentioned last week that there are those missals. We still are not having missalettes in the pews. But if you want to get that $5 missal that has all the Sunday readings for the next year, it's available in the bookstore. You're going to see in the pews those little blue flyers for you to take home. What is that? It's the We Share. The diocese is asking us to make this weekend a We Share Sunday. Why? It's possible. It's possible that we could go from code yellow to orange to red here, and then we would be suspending masses. That would be the worst, and yet it's a possibility. Please God, it will not happen. And if it does happen, a few things will kick in. We'll go immediately to virtual. Please tap into our Facebook page, where we'll be transmitting every mass live via Facebook, and then we reproduce it again on YouTube. But also, it's probably we're going to need financial help. There won't be any more Sunday collections. So we're asking our people to continue to support the church electronically. And it's really easy. I signed up years ago. That's my preferred way of giving, is to give electronically, because they don't bring the basket up to me up here. And also, I use my Capital One card, so I get the points. I get extra points for my credit card, so it works out. If I go on vacation, I know that my desire to meet the needs of the church can be met. And something that I want to share the unbelievable blessings that God has given me back to him. I would feel bad if I didn't. So that's why I choose the electronic giving, and it works for me. So I wanted you to have that in your hand. The diocese wanted to make sure you had it in your hand should we go back to all virtual again. Please God, we won't. Finally, this Thursday is Thanksgiving. And I mentioned before that for many of us, this was the worst year of our life. Many of us have lost loved ones.
we're sick and tired of being sick and tired of our masks and in this quarantine and all these restrictions. We're a lot under stress. There's a lot of people depressed and anxious. And yet, I, as your pastor, want to encourage you to do something that's maybe counterintuitive when things are in an awful year. What is that? To give thanks. We have to give thanks. Thank God, as Americans, we have a day we set aside. That's a very American thing. We have Thanksgiving. I know other countries are picking it up, which is great. But to dedicate an entire day to do, we do nothing else but give thanks to God. And interestingly, this is the 400th anniversary of the arrival of the pilgrims to America in 1620. Remember, they came, and so their first Thanksgiving, we traditionally recognize, was the following year. So it's even more fitting than ever. We only have one Mass this Thanksgiving. It's 10 o'clock. It's going to be in bilingual to get everybody together for one Mass. We tried to time it just right so that you can come back home and get the turkey in the oven, and there won't be any other problem. But to show gratitude is part of our deep spiritual need when we're going through tough times. Even St. Paul said it this way. He said in his first letter to the Thessalonians, whatever happens, give thanks, because it's God's will in Christ Jesus that you do this. So even in the worst of times, we give thanks to God. Hopefully we'll be able to come for Thanksgiving Mass this coming Thursday at 10 o'clock. And everybody, we could please stand for our final blessing and our St. Michael prayer. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all of the evil spirits who prowl throughout the world, seeking the ruination of souls. Amen.
Please join in singing our closing hymn, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is.